on today's show.
Which team has been the most pleasant surprise? Which squad has disappointed us all?
In the up-down report, we debate if the East is better than the West, and if the 95-96 Bulls would beat today's Dubs.
And Trey Kirby joins us live from the Roracle to get us set for tonight's Raptors-Warriors game.
It's Tuesday, November 17th. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or catching us live on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm Jay Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mullis.
Trey's not on set here, so I'm wearing a floral pattern in his honor.
Very nice. To Tass's right, it's the international man of mystery. Taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friends.
Lele.
Yes, Trey Kirby live in Oakland at the Oracle, getting ready for the Raps-Warriors game tonight on the network on NBA TV a bit later. Well, hopefully, fingers crossed, technology works with us. Hear from Trey a little bit later in the show. But we got an action-packed show here. We're going to start with this. Look, we're about, 10 or 11 games in. Most teams have played that much. Mm-hmm. Naturally, we've watched a lot of basketball. You included them at home, I'm sure. But I want to find out just how in sync everyone is when it comes to some early season opinions. Oh. Which is why we're playing, thanks to Swaggy P, Are You In Sync? It's very simple, Tass.
He actually wore that shirt.
He did. He was very proud of it. I'm going to throw out a question at you guys. Mm-hmm. I'll count you down. You guys, give us your answers at the same time. We'll see whether or not you're in sync.
Let's do this.
All right, very simple. First one. Which team has been the most pleasant surprise this year? In 3, 2, 1.
Pistons.
Wow.
No, it's not the Suns, Lee. It's not the Suns.
Why not?
When a guy like Andre Drummond is putting up Kareem numbers, Wilt Chamberlain-type numbers, you got to start with him. He's so confident he's growing out his shoulder hair. Don't think we didn't notice, Andre. And do it. Flaunt it. Flaunt that shoulder hair. You deserve it. You are doing so well. It's like the Anthony Davis eyebrow. I mean, he's going for it this year, and I love it. He's rebounding at 19 per game. Mm-hmm. I know it happened. It feels like a couple weeks ago, so it feels like they've kind of fallen off, but they went on a six-game West Coast trip. They've gotten that out of their system, and that's why at 5-5, no one would have predicted that they got to this point.
Why the Suns, Lee?
I'm saying the Suns because they had a pretty turbulent offseason. We had the business with Markieff Morris, and also their head coach, Jeff Hornacek, is basically in his last year of his contract right now. They could have extended him, and they chose not to. He's one of the lowest paid coaches out there, and I think he deserves an extension. I think he's done a fantastic job in his two seasons, and I thought that maybe those sort of situations had a little bit of roster turnover as well, losing Marcus Morris and adding Tyson Chandler. I thought that maybe the Suns were going to struggle a little bit because we know in the Western Conference you can't afford to get too far behind. Instead, they haven't had the toughest schedule, but they have gone out there and they've won games that they should be winning, and they're putting themselves in a position so that when they do maybe drop a couple of games later on, they're not going to be too far behind the rest of the pack.
You were super down, correct me if I'm wrong, on Tyson Chandler going to the Suns for that deal that he signed
for the length of that contract. Yeah, I thought for this first year he could be a good player, but I think at the end of that contract he might not be able to live up to it. But he has been fantastic for the Phoenix Suns, anchoring their defense, showing some leadership, and I'm happy to admit that I got it wrong.
The problem with the Suns is they don't really have a good win. They're 6-4, but as you said, they're taking care of bad teams.
Yeah,
I mean, the best team that they beat is the Clippers without Chris Paul and J.J. Redick. Then they beat the Kings without DeMarcus Cousins. And it's the Nuggets, Lakers, and Blazers. Yeah, that's all they got. Well, the Pistons, they took care of biz. They've beaten the Bulls, the Hawks, and the Phoenix Suns. So I think they've been more impressive. And yeah, it's because it sort of happened 10 days ago where they were on their 5-1 streak. But this young team, as you said, there's a ton of turnover on their team, more so than the Suns. Half their team is new.
But weren't you expecting this second year with Stan Van Gundy a significant improvement? Especially because of what we saw at the end of the second half of last season. They gave Reggie Jackson the big contract. Andre Drummond, we know he's not an All-Star this year, then he'd probably never be an All-Star. I thought that they were going to be a better team than last year.
I think the key word here, and I sort of like Tass's pick, is pleasant. Right. Pleasant surprise. The Pistons, over the last 5 or 6 years, have not been a pleasant team to watch. And they are this year. Well, they really are.
What's cool is that Stan Van has been a little persistent with Andre Drummond, almost stubborn, getting him into the post, almost to a point where it's hurt them the last couple of years. But you can't say you expected Andre Drummond to put up 18.5 and 19 rebounds.
No, but I'm not surprised that he's putting up big numbers because we know he's a super talented player. He's a big, big guy. He knows how to use his caboose well.
Yeah, that is. That skill, backing his way in, basically sort of like from the free throw line, get off me, just to get underneath, is a skill that no one on the Suns, I mean, no one really has throughout the league right now. It's just cool to watch. And the Suns have been good, but I think the Pistons
I'm a little shocked neither of you guys took the Celtics, but I guess you sort of were all in maybe at the beginning of the season. I'm sure some people out there picking the Celtics. Let's hear from you guys. Jump on Twitter, hashtag the starters with your answers. Next one here, guys. Let's flip it. Which team has been the most disappointing in the early season? 3, 2, 1.
Rockets.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
We are in sync.
We're in sync, baby.
Yeah.
We got Timberlake. We got Joey and Lance back here.
We talked a lot about the Rockets on yesterday's show and how disappointing they've been. And we thought perhaps they had a chance against the Celtics to maybe rectify some of that last night. They started off okay, and then they got absolutely drilled at home again. I pointed out yesterday they give up the most points in the paint by averaging 50 per game. Last night they conceded 58 to the Boston Celtics, who, when you look at the Celtics, they're a very well-organized team. Brad Stevens done a fantastic job, but they don't have someone who you think they're just going to pound the ball into, who's just going to dominate all night long, especially when Dwight was playing again. That was a very limp performance.
It was a very bad performance because they come in at 4-6. They're up double digits in the second quarter. The Celtics come back and tie it up. So going into the locker room, you think at 4-6, all right, we're going to turn it on. We got their best run. And then they get bombarded in the second half. I legitimately have to ask the question, do they like basketball? I mean, they're out there, it doesn't look like they're not into it whatsoever. Their leaders aren't into it, nobody is into it. And we're not entertainment tonight here, so I don't want to belabor this point, but I wonder if James Harden's issues off the court are bothering him. And I only mention it, not because I want to talk about it, but just because he's not himself
right
now.
He's been horrible.
And that's all. And his, you know, his girlfriend is dealing with her husband. And that's a problem, apparently, because he just doesn't look like... He's not getting anywhere close to the rim. His shot selection isn't the same. And defensively, they don't look anything like they were last year. Their leaders just aren't leading, as we mentioned. You go into a game like that against the Seas last night at home, you can't lose the first half and then lose the second half.
Ty Lawson said today, is quoted as saying, they already had a players-only meeting this morning. He said it was productive.
Yeah.
So maybe after talking about things now, they turn this around.
Before the game, Kevin McHale said, though, they've had all these talks already, and if they were a debate team, they'd be leading
league.
It was a brilliant quote. Look, I don't think Kevin McHale's in any trouble at all, because I think Daryl Morey likes him. I think he's his guy, and I think he's the right coach for that team. But anyone can get on the hot seat pretty quickly if they don't start
especially when it looks like it's
competing.
Just sort of competing.
Yeah.
Hustle, yeah. That's, I mean, that... You easily then go to the coach and go, why can't you get these guys fired up?
Yeah.
You're right. It seems weird to think that he might be on the hot seat. I got to eat a lot of crow here because I had the Rockets, in theory, in our preseason picks, winning a lot of regular season games.
Yeah.
I thought that would translate into a coach of the year for McHale. I thought that might translate into Harden, of course, being again in the MVP conversation, maybe winning that. I'm way off base here. I thought the Lawson move was great. That's looked horrible so far.
They looked to me a little
bit
like
they
did against the Clippers in the playoffs last season until they all of a sudden turned it on and came back and won that series. They looked terrible then, and then something happened and it changed. So perhaps it could happen again.
Lineup change coming, I think.
Yeah.
I think Ty Lawson has to go to the bench. I mean, he hasn't been himself.
Yeah. Well,
and just, he can't find himself. Yeah, as soon as Beverly comes back, even when Jason Terry can just sub in there.
Because
he doesn't look like himself. At least run the second unit, because with the first unit... He doesn't look anything like Ty Lawson.
Yeah, most people, I think, would pick the Rockets over the Pelicans, who are 1-9 and have been horrible as well. But a lot of people had
injuries,
the Rockets thinking, oh, yeah, they're going to be in the Western Conference Finals again, maybe going for a championship. All right, let's hear from you guys. All right, one more. Love this one. Which team has been the most entertaining train wreck? Count them down here. 3, 2, 1.
Kings.
What?
Okay.
Oh, the Kings have it all.
We are not in sync, apparently.
I'm shocked at this one. The Kings have the talent.
Yes.
Because it's fun to watch DeMarcus Cousins go off. But it's also fun to watch him go off in another way when he's angry and frustrated. He's angry and frustrated when he's scoring 40 points. He's like Russell Westbrook.
Yeah.
So it's fun to watch. I mean, this is my Real Housewives of Sacramento. It really is enjoyable in that regard. Also, Rajon Rondo has Sacramento eating out of the palm of his hands right now with the 3 triple-doubles last week. They're 4-7, and he has them eating out of the palm of his hands. There's just so many elements. George Karl is getting labeled as a coach who can't handle his guys. Well, I find that bogus. I mean, they're just not ready to play a lot of the time, and they just don't have the talent. I just find so many elements of this team a lot more entertaining than the Lakers, who don't have the talent.
But the Lakers are just hilarious to watch. And they're not the Lakers, they are the
Lakers! That's right.
No, because the whole Kobe farewell tour is enjoyable for me because Kobe...
When he's on the bench,
no,
injured.
Because, look, Kobe doesn't want people to take it easy on him. He wants them to go out and compete hard. And some are, and some teams aren't. But also, you just know with the Lakers, it's just there's a work in progress that's actually chaotic. You've got Byron Scott basically, I think, taking out his frustration on D'Angelo Russell, which is not fair at all. I think they've got to play D'Angelo Russell right now. Jordan Clarkson's a good player. He's also a little bit sort of in and out about his role in the team. And just watching the Lakers is just always hilarious. There's always something happening. So the Kings, they've got some talent. They've got perhaps...
That's the thing. The Kings have DeMarcus Cousins, which immediately makes between these two teams much more entertaining.
Yeah, and you saw against the Raptors on Sunday night. DeMarcus Cousins was brilliant when he took over. But the Lakers, I just don't know who's going to do that for them.
Two teams in California. Again, we'll hear from you guys. Jump on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Between those two teams, maybe you got someone else who's been the most entertaining train wreck this season. We got lots more still to come here on the show. When we return, we'll get those foam thumbs out. Get into the up-down report. Come on back. You're watching The Starters.
Rajon Rondo has played 48 minutes twice. That's entertaining.
Back with The Starters, we'll hear from Trey Kirby live in Oakland a little bit later in the show, but right now we're into the up-down report where we figure out where the three of us today stand on some hot-button NBA topics. Everyone's got their thumbs out. Lee, have you figured out how to use the thumbs?
Yeah, I've been working on it.
Yeah.
Well, nice.
No, you're okay. Yeah, down. Okay, there you go. Last
thumb
week...
Thumb goes up, thumb goes down.
Lee was a little confused how to do a thumbs down with... Whoa! Whoa! Nearly broke his arm trying to give us a thumbs down. Okay. So, we got a few here. Right. Play along at
See?
Home.
Look at that.
Jump
Mastered
on Twitter.
It.
Yeah, we know you can do the thumbs up.
Mastered it.
You can do the thumbs down there. Okay. First one here, guys. Last season, Western Conference, like the last couple of years, sort of killed the Eastern Conference when they played head-to-head. This year, they've flipped the script a little bit. The East is actually leading the head-to-head matchups 28-26. So the question is, up or down, on the East being better than the West?
Come on, Lee. Yeah, you can do it. Good work
Everyone
there.
Everyone goes thumbs down. No one's buying this.
Way thumbs
the
down.
The West still has the Golden State Warriors, who are clearly the title favorites right now. And the second title favorites for me are the San Antonio Spurs, who are second, and then the Cavs in the East. I don't really see another team outside of Cleveland in the East contending for the championship.
Spurs and Warriors, we should point out, are 7-1 combined against the East.
Yeah.
So it's all these other teams struggling right now.
That's exactly it.
But hold on, the East is better.
Yeah, and that's good to see.
Well, we knew coming into the season the second tier of the Eastern Conference was going to be better. The middle class. Unlike America, the Eastern Conference's middle class is strong.
Right.
But I blame the Rockets and the Pelicans, really. The Pelicans are 1-4 against the West. The Rockets are 1-2. Those are the teams that we expected to be a lot better against all teams, but haven't been. Mm. Really, it's 28-26. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. Okay. It's pretty even.
But Mark Cuban quoted as saying, you know, it is good for the league.
It's good for the competition.
It is,
sure.
At least right now, even if it gets out of hand
just
again.
Just can't see any of those East teams though, really being able to surge through and pass the Cavs.
Pass the Cavs.
Yeah.
All right, next one here, guys. Basketball Insiders reporter Tommy Beers, he recently asked Knicks rookie Kristaps Porzingis about a few nicknames, okay? He didn't like Zinger. Porzingis didn't. He didn't like Porzingod, but he did suggest KP or KP6. So are you up or down on Zinger's self-appointed nicknames?
Nah.
Down.
Yeah.
KP, KP6?
Yeah.
I mean, there's too many associations with KP. Kenny Powers, Kevin Pelton.
Yeah.
It's not going to work.
Shout out to Kevin Pelton.
And it's 10 games in. Let's not give the guy a nickname quite yet. Because I think of Kristaps. I mean, that's a great one. He's got the ups. He's throwing down the putbacks. But I don't want to label him with a nickname quite yet. Let him develop his game. I don't want a nickname to stick with him 10 games into his career and have it stick with him for years. Let the kid develop.
I'm always down on self-appointed nicknames.
Well, that too.
E-Dog will always be down on self-appointed nicknames.
Yeah, a man that calls himself E-Dog. There's two other things, right? When your name is Porzingis, we got to do better than just KP. I mean, that's just a great name in general. And then the only ever good sort of initials number nickname that comes to mind is AK-47, Kirilenko.
Yeah.
They don't usually work that way. Like, even CP3, it's not that great.
Not the same. Sometimes it does work in the past, but no, you've just got to wait. Let him, like you say, Tess, let him play a few more games first. Something's going to happen and something's going to stick.
You're right.
That's why he's giving himself a boring nickname, because he wants to let it breathe a little bit.
Is it Porzingis?
Yeah, okay. Very nice. All right, next one here. Love this one. We talked about it on yesterday's show. Last night, the Memphis Grizzlies rocking the throwback ABA Memphis Sound jerseys. Thumbs up or thumbs down.
I wish I had a second.
I mean, we're in sync on this this segment here. Yeah, these are amazing.
They are fantastic. And you saw Mario Chalmers rip it in these new jerseys. He had 29 last night. Quick question, guys. What's Mario Chalmers' career high?
29.
I'm going to say he got 33 once or something.
He got 34. It's kind of surprising. But so far, things have been going well. Dwayne Wade tweeted this last night as Mario Chalmers was going at it. Rio!
Thumbs up on that.
Yeah, pretty cool. You know, his old teammate. He also tweeted, "Proud big bro I am. Mario Chalmers, way to take that champion swagger to Memphis, Lil Bro. I mean, you don't have to call him Lil Bro. That's a little condescending.
But they used to yell at him.
Yeah.
That is the relationship, but it is cool. Yeah. Dwayne Wade, right on it. It wasn't a tweet later on when he found out the score.
He was
watching live. I saw that come up. That's a cool little moment. Mario Chalmers isn't going to score 29.
Every game?
Probably not.
No.
But I do like the swagger that he brings, and I think Memphis needs to slow their flow on thinking they're back. They're not back quite yet. They've got a three-game winning streak.
Good win last night, though.
Yeah, we're talking about the jerseys, though.
They beat the Thunder without Kevin Durant. But the jerseys, hey.
And they hit 12 threes in them, so they should wear them every game. They struggle doing that sometimes. All right, last one here. Love this one, too. Ron Harper's Warriors comments, all right? Five-time NBA champ Ron Harper wasn't overly impressed with the Warriors' hot start. Okay, so he got brought into a conversation on Twitter over the weekend. Former Bulls guard said his legendary 72-win Bulls team from 95-96 would sweep the reigning champs in a hypothetical matchup. He walked it back a little bit and said the Warriors might take a few games, but in the end, the Bulls would win. Are you thumbs up or thumbs down on Ron Harper in this hypothetical matchup?
Wow.
I'm thumbs up.
Thumbs up, too.
I love this because it gets people so irate.
Same here.
We will never, ever know. It's impossible to find out. But it's just great when an old guy who's retired, who had a lot of championship success, can just say, yeah, well, we'd still beat this new team, even though they play in a completely different way and they had a fantastic run. I just think it's great. For me, personally, it's very hard for me to see a Jordan team, finals team ever lose.
Yeah.
But I think it's great for Ron Harper just to stoke the fire.
Yeah, and he also made comments about Michael Jordan being the best ever. Yeah, we know that. I mean, Steph Curry just won a title in his sixth year, and this is his seventh year. Can we give him a year or two? Yeah, it's getting us fired up. All right, thumbs up.
All right, gotta take a break. When we come back, TK joining us live from the Oracle. It's Shaq stroking his beard again. Back with the starters. Great schedule on NBA TV tonight. We got the Bucks and Wizards at 7 p.m. Eastern, followed by the Raptors and Warriors. Golden State still undefeated. Can the Raps be the first one to hand a Manel? Unlikely. But right now we're joined by Trey Kirby live in the Roracle. Oh, it's action-packed in the Roracle right now. TK, how's it going?
Hey-o!
Hey-o! Trey Kirby, first things first. What is with this blazer? I've never seen you in a blazer.
You know, I'm trying to get my Craig Sager on, looking pretty snazzy here. I don't mean to brag, but I really think it fits me perfectly.
It looks great.
It looks fantastic. All right, I know you haven't been there too long, less than 24 hours actually out in Oakland, but tonight we are told that Golden State's doing the Hardwood Classics night. What exactly is in store for tonight from Golden State's perspective?
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's Hardwood Classics night. So the main thing is that the floor has been switched out, and it's not really the entire floor that's been switched out, but just the center tiles. I guess there's 15 tiles.
Okay.
According to Golden State's production manager, they take those out, switch them in, switch them out, and it looks like in the 1970s. It looks incredible around here. Also in the team shop, they've got a ton of merch, just really cool t-shirts, really cool shorts, everything you could possibly want to get if you're trying to look like a Warriors fan from the 1970s.
Lee wants to know if everything in the shop is pretty cool or pretty weird.
I would have to say that everything in the shop was equally pretty cool and pretty weird. My favorite thing I picked up, though, was this Hardwood Classics Stephen Curry doll. Gonna take it home to my little girl, Isla. You know she loves playing with NBA dolls.
Okay. I'm glad you added dolls to the end of that. TK, you went to shoot around today. What's the status with some of these Warriors players? Because, again, they're trying to keep this streak alive here. They're going for 12 straight wins to start the season. Draymond Green, is he playing? Klay Thompson, is he playing? What do you know?
They're both going to be playing, but I will say Draymond didn't have quite the same joy de vivre that you'd expect from that kind of guy. He was, just walking around like a guy who had been sick for the past couple of days, but he'll be there. Klay moving a little slow maybe, but still shooting 90% on wide open three, so I don't think it's going to be that big of an issue. But both guys playing tonight. Leandro Barbosa also back from Brazil.
Okay, great stuff. Also, you've had a busy day, despite not being there all that long. You got a chance to talk to MVP, reigning MVP, Steph Curry. How'd that go?
He's the nicest guy on earth, so it went perfectly, as you would imagine. I got to ask him about some of his creativity around the rim. The guy's shooting 70% in the restricted area this year. So I asked him what he's taken from a guy like Steve Nash, who's been helping out the team.
I gotta be creative because I can't dunk.
I don't know. I just saw you throw down a lefty right after the shoot-around.
I need a little alley-oop with a five-step gather, but I gotta be creative, try to get the ball in the glass, get it in when I'm in the paint. So that creativity is, I watch guys like Steve, like my teammate Leandro Barbosa, guys that are really clever around the basket without, you know, being above the rim kind of guys. So I've taken a lot from them, and just, you gotta be creative.
So we're gonna hear this entire interview with Curry on tomorrow's show. You wanna tease anything else you got into it with? I hope you talked to him about Lee helping him in the three-point contest at All-Star Weekend.
Well, I did ask him specifically about that. He was very thankful for Lee's help, and he offered Lee a few tips for being able to stay up late for those West Coast Warriors games. Really good stuff.
Okay, good.
I can't wait for that.
And let's get it on record here, Trey. Tonight, again, Raps Warriors here on the network. Do the Warriors keep the streak alive? Do they pick up win number 12? What do you think?
I think they do, and it will be 11 straight over the Raptors as well. It's been 2004 is the last time the Raptors win, so it's going to need a big-time performance from the Raps to pull it off, but I'm going with my man, Steph.
All right. You guys agree here at the table? Yeah, the last time the Raps won?
Yes. It was a long time ago.
Yeah, Vince Carter was playing, I believe.
Morris Peterson hit the game winner.
Yeah.
All right.
2004.
One of the toughest arenas to get a win in at the best of times.
All right, keep your eye on Trey Kirby's Twitter account tonight. He'll be, of course, at the game, at Trey Kirby, hashtag the starters. If you're in the area and you want a hug from the big guy in the blazer or stroke that beard like Shaq did. All right, we got to take a break. When we come back, Lilies. Very solid play of the night. Back with the starters, a look at last night's pick'em results. We all took the Memphis Grizzlies, I mean Memphis Sounds,
yeah,
as they look great in those throwback NBA jerseys. And we're all correct, so that's good news for all of us. The end of the month, the loser will have to do the pick'em payoff. It's something weird, it's something gross, it's something uncomfortable. I'm quite behind here, and we're halfway through this month.
And it's a short month, too.
It is a short month, that's right. We got the Thanksgiving holiday coming up here. So, that's why I am the only one going with the Bucks tonight on the road. You guys are all backing the Wizards. So, I mean, look, I desperately need this win. Lee, where are we going for very solid play?
We're going to Houston, but it's actually the Boston Celtics with the very solid play. Now, watch the ball movement here. It's like a GIF, or GIF, whatever you call it, on loop. Goes around once and then twice.
I'm dizzy.
And then finishes with Amir Johnson with that beautiful little, is that a dinker or a dumper there, Tassie?
Hold on, watch Amir Johnson. How long is he? Oh no, okay.
Yeah.
He gets out. Okay,
yeah.
Good. He's fine.
He drops it in. That's beautiful. That's what I call a very solid play.
All right, guys, stick around for FanDuel Fantasy Tip-Off with Jared Greenberg.
Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, no time for a quote.
Brace the night.